Our reading from the Hebrew Bible today is a recap of the Ten Commandments. There are several things to learn about them, which is a reminder that Bible study is like housework. If you keep at it a little at a time, on an ongoing basis, it yields solid results. Some things we learn may come as an eye-opener to many. But as we have discussed in the Presbyterian tradition, we love to learn, and we love to keep up with how scholars look at the text. When we hear what they have to say, we can be mindful of how we get our own meaning out of the Bible. It's careful work, but it's rewarding. You may remember a story I told you a few weeks back about an unfortunate congressman. He was defending one of his counties for having the Ten Commandments installed in the courthouse. When he was interviewed, the reporter said, "What are the Ten Commandments?" The congressman said, "What?" The reporter said, "What are the Ten Commandments?" The congressman thought and said, "Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal." He got like four of them. If you're going to speak strongly in favor of a law or a legal position based on something in the Bible, one should read the Bible first. One should know what one is talking about. I would advise against saying, "Well, it's true because it's in the Bible." That is selling the Bible short. It's much richer and more complex than that. If you're familiar with any number of weird ancient tales that may not come up in the lectionary, you will know what I mean. For example, God once sent a bunch of bears to eat some children who were mocking a prophet. Or when Samson lost a bar bet and had to come up with 30 sets of clothing to pay off the bet, God provided 30 harmless strangers for Samson to kill and recycle their tunics. The Bible is our sacred text, but believing in it blindly without study is a mistake. Now, you may have heard a variation in today's reading, "Thou shalt not murder," instead of "thou shalt not kill." "Thou shalt not kill" is a mistranslation, a misinterpretation. The Hebrews were certainly okay with defending yourself, defending your family, defending the nation. War would happen. There would be no Bible if there was an abject ban on killing. There are going to be peace churches like the Amish who would never accept this update on their beliefs, this correction on the basic text that has been the root of a basic tenet of their tradition. And they have every right to maintain that tradition. But we need to move forward with what modern scholarly work tells us is a mistake. The original King James Version, the first official Bible in English, had over 600 translation errors, but it was very beautiful. The New King James has fewer errors and is still a great read. But the New Revised Standard Version that we use here is put together by editors and scholars and academics who are very careful to balance accuracy with accessibility. That is why our Lord's Prayer says, "Forgive us our debts." Debt is a killer, a crippler. Compounding interest is an irresistible force. It will crush anyone who cannot get out from under it. "Forgive us our debts" does have metaphorical power in how we become indebted to each other and how we become indebted to God by sinning and being forgiven. But first, it's important to not brush aside the literal meaning here. We forgive debts. We will spend some time on these Ten Commandments in the near future. I would like to do a study of each commandment, one per week, to see what they're about. It's only a start. There's actually 613 commandments. The Jewish scholars say, "Why do Christians make such a big deal of the first 10? The next 603 cover things like eating kosher food, not eating camels or gnats, not eating shrimp or lobster or pork, The Jews know the Hebrew Bible better than we do. The Jews venerate the Hebrew Bible. They study it. They discuss it. They argue about it. And so do we. We read it. We depend on it. We find it to be useful, valuable, insightful. We can do a better job of studying it. But we also use reason and logic to decide what has meaning and what does not. I'm sure everyone here would have trouble eating camel meat. But most people here would not object to a pork roast, a steaming lobster with butter, or a shrimp cocktail. In our tradition, we choose not to follow all 613 commandments. That is a rational application of critical thinking skills. Let's move on to our text from Paul. Paul's letter to the church in Corinth, in Greece, talks about reason and logic. Let's unpack it for a bit. Verse 18, "For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart." Paul has done a rewrite from Isaiah 29:14, which reads like this. "Therefore, behold, I will again do wonderful things with this people, with wonder upon wonder. And the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the discernment of their discerning men shall be hidden." End quote. Remember, Paul is a highly trained Pharisee, rigorously schooled in the Hebrew text. Let us continue. Verse 20. "Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world?" End quote. Here Paul is talking about the experts of his age, something both Hosea and Jesus preached against. People who were scribes and Pharisees who interpreted the Bible too literally, instead of with justice and mercy. It is also about the Greek community of experts in philosophy, which is about aesthetics, morality, wisdom, but also survival, acquisition, selfishness, fear of the other. Jesus speaks to a higher standard, one that transcends the getting and spending of this earthly life. Jesus connects us to eternity through the teaching of eternal truths about how we can connect our behavior to God's love. Here's some more. Verse 23. "But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles," end quote. Or, "a stumbling block to the non-Christian Jews who cannot conceive of the idea of a crucified Messiah." That idea is irrational. A Messiah is a savior, someone who would save the Jews from the Romans. Jesus did not do that. This is foolishness to the Jews who are not following Jesus. By New York standards, Jesus is a loser. A loser. He goes to Jerusalem and provokes the authorities. He does not fight back when he's arrested. He asks God to forgive those who are executing him. Such a loser. Back to Paul, verse 24. "But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength." How else could we see God's foolishness? How about love your enemy? This is hard for people to swallow. It sounds irrational. Who are the enemies in our lives? Well, sometimes aren't we our own worst enemy? When I make a mistake, I have a hard time forgiving myself. Or some family member or coworker is a source of irritation. If we take the root of compassion, we would say, what is the pain that person is in? that is causing them to cause pain for me. Thich Nhat Hanh, the Buddhist monk, said, "You cannot forgive until you feel compassion for someone. You may want to forgive them, but you cannot." Forgiveness is a central form of what love is, especially when we need to love someone who is causing us pain. But forgiveness is not a simple thing, not something to be defined in a sentence. Forgiveness is not saying that what happened is okay. What it is saying is, I am letting go of my hurt. I'm letting go of my anger. I'm not going to hold a grudge. Holding a grudge is like holding a hot coal in your hand that you're going to throw at the person you're mad at the next time you see them. It feels good to be right, to hold on to righteous anger. But it is more important to let go of the anger than it is to hang on to being right. I'm not going to hold on to thoughts of revenge, large and small. I'm letting go and moving on. God's weakness is not seeking revenge, which to the world is weakness. It is irrational. But for us, it is the strength to love. Dr. King once said, "Goodness defeated is stronger than evil triumphant." How can that possibly make sense? It sounds irrational. It means that when the bad news seems insoluble, we have to know that God is still working. God has not given up. God's will still moves. The progress of the world may not be up to our standards. The bad news is very bad, and there is a lot of it. Is it rational to be optimistic or irrational? Not if you have a belief in and an understanding of God's power. Remember from Isaiah, "Therefore behold, I will again do wonderful things with this people, with wonder upon wonder." If you believe in God's love, you will believe that any single defeat we see does not mean that good has lost its power. It means that goodness has lost only one battle. This moment of evil triumphing over good is but one moment, because God's weakness is stronger than evil triumphant. The power of God transcends our ability to reason. It transforms our ability to work out what is happening. God's power is transrational. It is above and beyond even rationality. It transcends and transforms our rationality. It is why we call our confidence in the power of God's love a belief. It is faith. It has a power of transformation that rationality can only dream about. Let us pray. Dear God, our Creator, bless us with belief in your strength, in your power to overcome our weaknesses. Give us the faith to become more than what we could do by ourselves. Fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit to forgive those who need our forgiveness, to love those who aren't so very lovable, to know that you are at work in the world, even when we do not see it. Your power transcends and transforms us. Help us to be open to it. All this we ask in your name. Amen.